Hi everyone, welcome back to S&G Family Farm. Today we are going to start talking about seeds and when we should be getting started and what we are growing this year. So I basically have four categories in which I keep my seeds collected. So I have flowers. You always want to put flowers in your garden. They help bring in the pollinators and help your vegetables produce the fruit that you want to eat. Then you have your herbs. Herbs can also be a great thing to have, especially if you interplant them with your certain produce and stuff, because it will actually aid in them growing and it will help keep pests and stuff away. So that's always good when you're in a garden and you need to think about those kind of things. Third, we have our cold crops. So like cabbages, broccoli, cauliflower, that kind of stuff. Those are actually, depending on your zoning, you can grow them either all winter long or it's a spring and fall crop. In the spring, you probably tend to have to get them started indoors versus in the fall. You can start them outdoors and then plant them and grow them through at least a good hard frost. And then, of course, you have your summer crops. So your tomatoes, peppers, okra, corn, stuff like that that you're going to direct sow. In the summertime. So after your last frost date, usually a couple months after your last frost date. So it just really depends on your area and when your last frost date is going to be. Now understand that your last frost date is just a guess. Okay. I know here in Zone B in Amarillo, our last frost date falls in the middle of April. Because of how many years we have had a late frost or even snow, we've had snow clear up into May sometimes, I never plant any of my summer crops until the middle of May or after. So just keep in mind that with things like tomatoes and peppers that you're starting indoors, know when you're going to plant, not just your last frost date, but know when you plan on planting them out, and then count back from there, not just from your last frost date. Because if you start them too early and you do have that late frost, or you do happen to have some bad weather like a freak snowstorm or something like that, then it's going to leave your plants sitting in conditions that are not good for them. So just think about that. It's always better to start them a little bit later and plant them out smaller than to start them earlier and then with the risk of them getting root rot or something else and them dying before you can get them planted out. So just keep that in mind when you're going through this. So I'm actually going to be following two, I don't know what you would call them. They're growing challenges basically. So one of them is going to be with Becky at Acre Homestead. She actually has She worked it up a deal with Haas Tools during the Homestead Homesteaders Conference. And she has a seed bag set up for container gardening. So you can go on there and you can either order that seed bag from Haas Tools. It's about $75. It's under Acre Homestead Container Gardening. Or you can just take a look at what's in there and go through your seeds and see what you have that corresponds with that and just use that. There's no hard, fast rules with the containers or anything else like that. It's just a grow along. You know, kind of gives you an idea where to start. If you've never done really any homesteading or gardening before, you live in an apartment or something like that, it's a good place to start. She's got good varieties that are really good for container gardening in there. And it kind of gives you an idea that what you can grow with limited space and resources. The second is going to be with Nicole on Flower Hill Farm. She's up in New York. She does have a YouTube channel also. And she is doing a flower grow along. And that flower grow along, the place that she ordered set up and to get your seeds from, they're already sold out. So just like with Becky, you can just look and see the variety. She has a YouTube video talking about this. What varieties she's going to be growing, and then you can just go get them. They're going to be super easy. They're pretty much stuff that everybody has or most people like to grow anyway. So like zinnias and sunflowers and like snapdragons and stuff. So it's a pretty easy going thing. Some of these work really good in container gardens. Others need to be planted in ground. So kind of like the sunflowers, they need a bit more room and stuff. Well, but that also depends on the variety of sunflowers. There are some very small sunflowers that don't get very tall, 12 to 24 inches, that would work really well in a container. So just look at your varieties that you have available and consider that when you go to put those in. Okay, so let's get started with herbs first. Let's talk about the herbs. So herbs are a pretty easy thing to grow. You can actually, if you have a grow light setup and stuff like that, some of these herbs are really easy to grow indoors, even throughout the winter. So first off, we're going to be growing some parsley. I use a lot of parsley in my cooking and stuff, and we go through a lot of it. I will add it to just about anything. It's high in vitamin C and really healthy for you. The second is going to be cilantro. I plan on canning a lot of salsa. My husband eats a ton of salsa. That's his favorite go-to snack, is salsa and chips. So I plan on being able to harvest a lot of salsa. The only thing I'm not growing this year for salsa is going to be garlic. So I will have to purchase garlic to make the salsa. But, you know, when it comes to seeds, I'm not going to tell you there's a hard, fast rule of where you're going to order from, where you need to pick them up. This time of year, you know, the box stores and stuff have them, maybe in a smaller variety, but home improvement stores have them, Lowe's, Home Depot, they already have their seeds and stuff out. So you can just go take a look. A lot of what you find in Home Depot and places are going to be like Burpee or Fairy Morse. Those are pretty common when it comes to seeds, when you can get in just about anywhere. So just think about that. Think ahead of time. Now is definitely the time you want to start picking up your seeds. I'm not saying those are the only places you can get them from. I've ordered from Johnny Seeds. I've ordered from, Gurney. I have ordered from Baker Creek. Wherever you can get them. I've got some in here that I got from the Dollar Tree. It doesn't make any difference. Seeds are seeds. Nothing that is sold for us to grow as home gardeners is going to be GMO. So let's get that straight right here and right now. Everything that's available is either just going to be standard stuff, or you can buy organic. It's really up to your preference. And heirloom seeds have their pros and cons. They're going to be less disease resistant. And when you're starting out, dealing with diseases is not going to be your friend. However, if you want to try a variety, go for it. There's nothing wrong with trying something that you've never tried before. This is not a exact science. It's more of a scientific experiment every time you plant something in your garden. So I'm not going to talk about where I got these unless it's something very specific that I couldn't find anywhere else. Okay. So cilantro. I got this one from Dollar Tree. When this is something that you're going to be planting in high bulk quantities to be able to harvest all at one time for something very specific, then you know what? There is nothing wrong with going and buying a pack from Dollar Tree. So we got parsley and cilantro. Sage, while we don't eat a lot of sage, sage can have very medicinal purposes. Along with other things, it does taste really good with poultry and stuff when you're cooking poultry. So you always want to think about that. So we have dill. Dill, carrots, believe it or not, are actually in the dill family. So, you know, think about that. Dill, I'm going to be doing a lot of pickling and stuff. And so you definitely want to be able to have dill. It's not just dill leaves, but if you let them go to flower, the dill heads are really good also. They actually tend to have a little bit more flavor than just the leaves. So give that a consideration when it comes to pickling. I cook a lot of Italian food, and we're going to be canning a lot of, hopefully some pasta sauce and some pizza sauces. So oregano. Oregano is on the top of my list this year for herbs. What else we got here? Basil. I've got two different types of basil. I've got this beautiful red basil. And then I just got your standard sweet Italian basil. So again, nothing hard and fast when it comes to rules. It's whatever you want to give it a try. And then of course there's thyme. We're going to be growing some thyme. So this is a herb. You can harvest the leaves, but you can also eat the flowers. So it is, you know, very versatile. And then of course we got some lemon balm. Be careful with anything in your mint family. So catmint, lemon balm, spearmint, peppermint. Those are really better to be planted in a container anyway, because they will take over your garden before you know what's happened. And then it's a struggle to keep everything in its place and keep it from taking over. So just keep that in mind. All right, so let's go on to our cold crops here. I'm actually going to be probably starting these because these are pretty fast mature dates and stuff on some of this stuff. Probably end of February, beginning of March. That way they can be planted out right around my frost date in April. And then they can be harvested, you know, May, June. So let's take a look here. So some of these, okay, so we've got some bunching onions. This is going to be one of those that's like a good for container garden. They're also known as green onions. So they're not going to be, you're not trying to grow these for the size of the bulb necessarily at the bottom. Green onions can, if left, grow a bulb, but not necessarily. Most of the time when you grow green onions, you want it for the tops, not for the bulb part. And then, of course, we've got three types of onions this year. We're going to be growing a red onion. This one's good for storing. You've got your standard white onion. This one is also a storing onion. And then I've got a Spanish sweet yellow. This one is more for eating and is not going to store well because of the higher sugar content in it. So that's something you need to keep in mind, especially when it comes to preserving. So then we've also got this lettuce mix. Now this is more like a cut and come again. You're not trying to let it reach a head state. It's got a shorter maturity date on it. But it just, you can leave it to get to a head, but most of the time when I plant this, it's just for, you know, like the baby greens type salad. I got spinach here. We got the Bloomingdale longstanding spinach. This one is bolt resistant, which means as it starts getting a little bit hotter, it's less likely to bolt on you and go to seed. So it's better to be planted. It's really good to plant in the spring and stuff. I've got some Utah celery. I've never tried growing celery before, so we're going to try and do that this year. I like to chop it up and put it in the freezer, especially the tops of it. They make really good for stews and soups and stuff. So it gives you a good vitamin C kick in that. I got some other type of greens. I've got some arugula, some leaf green leaf lettuce, and then I've got also got some head lettuce here along with some kale. So again, kale is a really good for as far as processing. It doesn't take much to process. So you just pick the leaves, you rinse them really good, and then just throw them in the freezer. Put them in a bag and throw them in the freezer. Once they're cold and frozen, they break apart really well, and you don't have to worry about chopping them up into little pieces and everything else. That, you know, the freezer's done a lot of the hard work for you. And then we've got three types of head lettuce here. I've got a bib lettuce. This is an heirloom type seed. I've got a butter crunch lettuce, and then which is really good for making wraps and stuff. And then I've got your standard romaine type lettuce, good for Caesar salads and stuff like that. So there's three types of lettuces. Now the romaine lettuce, because of the way it grows in a more upright type of situation. That is going to be one of those varieties that is good for container gardening. So just keep that in mind. Let's see what else we've got. We have carrots. I actually have two types of carrots. One of these, this is going to be a red cord chantney. Not really sure. It's actually going to be a shorter. They don't grow quite as long. And of course, anytime you have carrots, you can always harvest them earlier and when they're still kind of young. So you kind of have the small, easy to roast carrots in the full stature. So just keep that in mind when it comes to carrots. You can always harvest them earlier than the maturity date. It really just depends on the size of carrot that you fully want. Now, granted, if you are looking for a storage carrot, you are going to let them grow to the maturity date so that when you go to harvest them, they're a lot easier. Other things we've got. We've got beets. I'm going to be trying turnips this year. They're supposed to be really easy to grow and can take place of potatoes. You're supposed to be able to cook them similar to potatoes and mash them up, and they don't have much of a different flavor for the potatoes. I believe they have a little bit more spiciness to them, a little bit more of a bite to them. So, I mean, it's something to give you a try. Again, turnips are one of those things you can grow in a container garden, and you can harvest them early. And then we have, of course, cherry radishes. Those are really good for salads. You can roast them and eat them like potatoes also. And then, of course, we've got cauliflower and Brussels sprouts and broccoli. I don't know that I'll get these planted this spring. I may wait till fall. These kind of things, actually, and especially Brussels sprouts, they taste sweeter after their first frost. For whatever reason, there's some sort of chemical reaction that once they go through a first frost, it makes them sweeter. So, I mean, give that a consideration when you're planting. You say you don't like Brussels sprouts, but maybe you've only tried them when they've been grown and harvested in the spring, and so they always kind of have that bitter flavor to you. So why don't you try planting them in the fall, letting them go through a first frost, and then try roasting them and see how you like them. Sometimes it just comes down to that little thing, little difference. And then, of course, we've got some cabbage, green and red, we're going to be growing this year. Again, probably one of those is going to be for this fall. So that is a good start as far as our spring crops, spring and fall crops. All right, let's talk about the main part of our garden this year. Some of these varieties I am going to be planting out at my mom's house. I think they will do better out at her place. She has a little bit more room and less sun restrictions, like as far as fencing and stuff, blocking the amount of sun that they're going to be getting. So I think they will do a better job out at my mom's house. So we're going to be taking that into consideration. I don't have all my varieties here because I said I did order some from Baker Creek, which isn't a big deal. They're supposed to be here on Tuesday. So I'm not going to wait for them, but a lot of them are just extra tomato varieties and some flowers. Let's see what we got. So let's talk tomatoes. So I'm going to have two types of cherry tomatoes. I'm going to have just your standard hybrid cherry tomato. So that'll make it good for a container garden. They're a determinant type, so they're only going to get so big and they're only going to put off so much produce at one time. I will also be having a variety called Black Strawberry Cherry Tomato from Baker Creek. That's a variety I've never tried. Generally, most people just stick with what they know. So either a red or an orange or a yellow cherry tomato. But I'm interested to try this one. It's supposed to be a little bit more fruity when you eat them. So it's going to be interesting. I have your standard red hybrid slicer tomato. I've also got a Cherokee purple tomato I'm going to be growing this year for a slicer. And then I'm going to have an Aunt Ruth's green tomato from Baker Creek that I'm interested to try. I love fried green tomatoes, but it's such a hassle to have to go out there and pick a tomato that's still green when I know I could just let it ripen and I will, get more of a garden harvest to make salsa and stuff with. So I specifically looked for a green tomato this year that I could use as a slicer tomato and that I can make salsa verde with. I've never tried growing tomatillos. I'm much more familiar with tomatoes, so I'm just going to try doing green tomatoes this year, and then maybe next year tomatillos will be one of those things that I will try in the garden and experiment with so that I can see how they do. And then, of course, I'm going to have three types of Roma/paste tomatoes. I'm going to have your standard San Moranzo paste tomato. And then I'm going to have your standard Roma tomato. And then I'm going to try the Korean long tomato this year, too, from Baker Creek. It's supposed to be a little bit larger as far as the Roma/paste tomatoes. So I'm hoping I'll be able to get more meat off of it and be able to make more pasta sauces and stuff with that. Instead of just having to try and get a lot of smaller Roma and paste tomatoes. So we're going to give that a shot. Moving on to our peppers. Let's see what we've got in here. Last year I tried to find straight up cayenne pepper. I used cayenne pepper in a lot of my cooking because my husband really likes spicy stuff. And I can control the heat with cayenne pepper versus trying to just buy something in the grocery store or something like that. So I bought this hot pepper mix. It was the only place I could find cayenne pepper last year because everybody knows seed buying last year was a nightmare. But it comes with jalapeno, cayenne, Anaheim, poblano, serrano, and a Hungarian wax. So, but they're all mixed in the same packet. So I'm not really sure. I'm going to try growing like 4 pots of these and just see what happens to come up. But I do have some other peppers here. I have a hot banana pepper I'm going to try out. I really like pickled banana pepper and stuff, and you know, hot is always good. I have a kind of a banana pepper. It's the long pepper blend sweet pepper. This is going to be probably for pickling and stuff. And then of course, my husband is a fan of Olive Garden salads, so we're going to be growing some Greek peppuccino peppers. It's just, if you go through so many of them, there's no point in buying them in the grocery store. You might as well just grow your own. And then I did find straight up cayenne pepper. So I'm going to be trying to grow some cayenne pepper and dry it out to make my own cayenne pepper. And then, of course, you can't go wrong with your sweet bell peppers. So we're going to have some sweet bell peppers this year. Hopefully, I can get them to produce. I've never had much luck with bell peppers in this area for me. They never get very big. They always stay pretty small. So we're going to see what we can do to make them a little bit bigger. Okay, moving on to cucumbers. I'm only going to go two varieties of cucumbers this year. I've got my straight up pickling cucumber. We want to do pickles. We want to try fermented pickles. So we're going to give that a try. And then of course your straight up garden slicing, the straight 8 standard slicer cucumber for salads and just for munching. Summer squash. I love me some zucchini. You can't go wrong with zucchini in my opinion. Fried, grilled. Honestly, my favorite way to eat zucchini is sliced and grilled. It's just, to me, there's no other better way to eat it. And then of course we're going to grow some standard yellow straight neck squash. A lot of people say you can grow these in a container, so that we're going to kind of experiment with the yellow squash. I'm not a huge fan of yellow squash. We grew up eating it a lot and it kind of burned me out on it. So I do like it grilled, but I don't need a variety of it. I don't need a bulk amount of it. So we're going to try the yellow squash in a container, so if I don't get a lot off of it, then I don't have to really worry about missing my production from that, unlike my zucchini. Okay, and we've got green beans and peas here. I have the standard Blue Lake stringless pole bean. So I have this in a pole bean version, which means it's going to vine and get pretty tall. And then I also have it in the bush version. We're going to try the bush version in a container gardening, so we're gonna give that a shot. And then of course we have the sugar daddy sweet peas. We're gonna give those I want some of those early spring peas this year. And then we're gonna be growing black beans and black eyed peas. I do not eat black eyed peas any other way but fresh from the garden with some snaps in them. I don't think they taste good at all any other way. So out at my mom's place, that's where we're going to plant the black-eyed peas and the black beans. We're also going to do some corn out there. This is their standard hybrid corn. No, it is not GMO. Like I said before, GMO seeds can only be sold to mass production farmers. It cannot be sold to individual persons for homegrown. The only thing you have to worry about is planting corn is that you're not within 250 feet of a genetically modified version. There's nobody around the area in which I am planting corn within that range that's going to have that grows corn genetically modified. So I'm not going to have to worry about that. If you are worried about that, most genetically modified corn is planted early so that it can come to maturity faster and be harvested faster. So if you want to, you can delay your harvest. If you have a shorter maturity date on your corn, you can wait later. Therefore, it will mature after the corn that's already been harvested from the GMO corn. So just give that a thought when you go to plant your corn. We are also going to be growing okra. Okra is amazing. We like to dry it and use seasoning salt on it. It is a great replacement for potato chips. I personally cannot get enough. I actually have 2 varieties here. I'm not really sure which one I'm going to try. We are going to try the standard one most people grow is going to be the Clemson Spineless, so that's probably what we got. But I also have this one that's called Emerald. I've never personally tried this version before, so we're going to give that a shot. And then, of course, as far as our winter squash goes, we're going to have some sugar pie pumpkins. I want to make some pumpkin butter this next year for gifts and stuff, and I personally love pumpkin butter. How can anybody not love pumpkin everything? I know, there are people out there. I don't understand it either. Some long-storing winter squash we're also going to be growing is going to be some spaghetti squash. I do have some acorn squash in my seed pack, so I will be trying to grow some acorn squash. I like to just cut these in half and roast them, kind of like patty pan. I just think they taste really, really good. And then, of course, we're going to be growing some sugar baby watermelons. So we're going to give that a shot and see how those go. That's it for our summer stuff. The only thing I have left that we're going to go over is going to be our flowers. Like I said, you want to grow flowers in your garden. If it's just at the end of a row, there's so many beneficial things. It brings in your pollinators. It will increase your harvest size because there are stuff out there pollinating your flowers and stuff, especially with tomatoes and stuff. You have to have those pollinators. And in order to bring those pollinators in, you need something that smells sweet and looks delicious. So, especially to those bees and stuff. And bees are not the only insects that help you pollinate your flowers and pollinate your vegetables. So keep that in mind. Plant a variety of them. So we are going to have some morning glories. Now you have to be careful with morning glories. If you have animals and stuff, I'm going to be growing these in my backyard and they're going to be secluded. So we don't have to worry about my dog getting into them. And it's not going to be around farm animals like goats trying to eat them. So this is going to be in a urban setting where animals can't get to them. I'm actually going to be using them for a shade for the back of my house, which is west facing. And our air conditioner, we do have an older house, and our air conditioner really struggles in the summer because we get all the sunlight and all this heat on the backside of our house, and it just heats up our house. So I'm going to try and create kind of like a shade trellis in order to help cut that down with those. Let's see, what else do we got here? I've got some, just for some pure fun and works great in a container, I've got some rose moss. This stuff is so much fun. It is so drought tolerant and heat tolerant, and it will just keep blooming clear up until a heavy frost. I just love this stuff. It's so easy to grow, and it's just a great, great little picture here. We're going to be growing some zinnias. So I have just a standard variety mix here. I've also ordered some of the Queen Lime series, I believe it's called, from Baker Creek. Jess over at Roots and Refuge was talking about them, and I saw pictures of them, and I just knew I had to have them. They're kind of got this just lime feel to all of the series, but I just really like the way they look. They kind of had like an antique-y look to them, and I just really thought they would be a lot of fun. We're going to try out some snapdragons. I've never tried snapdragons before, but it's, you know, cut flowers. How can you go wrong with them? I've got two types of sunflowers. These giant mammoth sunflowers I'm actually going to plant at my mom's house at the end of my chicken run. There's not any shade really out there, so I'm going to plant these to help shade my chicken run during some of the hottest part of the day. And then at the end of the time, I can just cut them off and I have something to feed to my chickens later. And then I have this beautiful autumn colored one that I don't know. This one is supposed to get 4 to 6 feet high. So this one I may be planting over here at our house in town. I have three types of marigolds I'm going to try planting. I have this wonderful little petite yellow. They get 6 to 8 inches tall. They're going to be great for your container gardening. And this is one of those beneficial flowers that's not just for bees and stuff, but it also keeps away pests. Marigolds are one of those plants and flowers that give off a slight ammonia smell to them. So it really helps deter dogs and cats and rabbits and stuff from getting in with your gardening stuff. So we've got the really short one. I've got a medium height one here. It's supposed to reach about 12 inches. This one's a variety pack color. We've got some deep red, oranges, and some yellows in there. And then these are some giant ones. These are supposed to get 2 to 3 feet tall. I've never seen marigolds get that tall, so we're going to give those a shot. I'm interested to see how tall they get. And then, what else we've got in here? Oh, yes, you can't go. Everybody should be growing calendula. Calendula is such a beautiful flower. It kind of has a daisy look to it, but it is so beneficial. You deadhead the plant when it's in full bloom, and they'll just keep producing more flowers, but you dry those flowers, and you make salves and stuff with them. They are amazing and very beneficial. And then, of course, we've got chamomile. Chamomile is an amazing plant. It helps with calming stuff, and it is so easy to grow and so easy to harvest. We are also going to be growing some echinacea. It's in the coneflower family, just like Rebecca is. I can't find any Rebecca. That's one of the flowers on Nicole over at Flower Hill Farms, Grow With Me. I can't find Rebecca. I'm not going to search for Rebecca. It's in the coneflower family. I have Echinacea, so that's all great. I don't have my Echinacea here, right here, right here. The second is actually in my refrigerator getting cold stratified. It's one of those that has to be cold stratified. We're also going to be growing some Yarrow. This is a beautiful, beautiful pastel mix. Got that really antique-y feel to it. I can't wait to grow this. This is one I do believe that needs to be cold stratified. No. No, this one doesn't have to be cold stratified. It's this other one, Cut and Come Again, one that I'm going to be growing, which is the Peruvian Lily or the Astromeria. You see this a lot in grocery stores. You know, you get those $5 little bundles and stuff. And they are my absolute favorite cut flower. They're inexpensive. They last forever in vase life. I mean, forever. I have had a bouquet of Astromeria last in a vase for 5 weeks without a single one of them dropping a petal. Just with a water change once a week. They are absolutely amazing. And then I have this huge bag of Nostrum. I mean, and when I say a huge bag, I mean a huge bag. This has got, I don't know. This is a quarter pound bag of Nostrum seeds. This is a variety bag. It's got a lot of the oranges and reds in it. And then I do have another one. That's got a beautiful, these are kind of look like Hawaiian flower nostrum. So I just had to have those. Those were like, so they were so much fun. So that is what we're going to be growing this year, a variety of them. I may not grow all of these. I may give some of them a try. It just kind of depends on what I can get as far as my garden beds and stuff going and everything. Some of the flowers I may not grow. I forgot. I do have lavender also. I'm going to try getting growing. Lavender is a super beneficial plant. And then I also have giant hyssop. I had bought this last year and I haven't managed to get them. I haven't tried germinating these or anything. So I may try this year. I may wait till next year. And so just because you buy your seeds 1 year doesn't mean you have to plant everything in that year. Seeds don't go bad per se. They may lose over time if you don't keep them in a good secure location. They may lose their germination rate, which means you plant 5 seeds, 1 may grow. Versus the first year you get them, you plant all 5 and all 5 germinate. So that's just something to consider. Seeds don't go bad. I mean, that's why we have seed vaults and stuff all around the world. Because seeds don't go bad. Like I said, you just lose your germination rate. Your germination rate will lower. But something will grow even if you have a lower germination rate. So that is the seeds for this year, for 2022. Lot to pick from, lot to go through, lot to grow, different seasons and everything else. We look forward to seeing what everybody's grown this year. Don't forget to be posting pictures. Next time we're going to be talking about your grow light setups and your growing medium. And then we're going to get some stuff planted and started probably beginning of February. So like our tomatoes and peppers and stuff like that. So thank you for joining in. If you like this video, don't forget to like and subscribe. And please share.